thanks, everybody. It has been a wonderful time here at the Gavel, and I appreciate all the support, and I'm excited. Bob, you're waiting here in Austin, and I've gone.
I'm not too far.
About right here. Okay, so you want people first, or you want to, oh, just kidding.
Oh, everybody.
Go all the way around, and then hand it over to Michael to nominate the new board members.
Okay. So let's start with the new gentleman, Drew.
Hi.
And we'll go that way.
Good afternoon, my name is Drew Planting with GPI, and we own the Amoeba Records Building, and I was in Carrie's other bid for four years, up until the middle of last year, and now I'm glad to be here.
I'm Kimmy Gordiel, I'm the Development Director for the Hollywood YMCA.
Adam Tarkovsky with Crescent Heights, Hollywood Palladium, and the Palladium Residences. Happy to join the team here.
Michael Normand, Hollywood Athletic Club, dad's owned the building since '86.
Carrie Morrison.
Fred Rosenthal with Amatron.
I'm Mike Pogorzelski, the Director of the Academy Film Archive at the Pickford Center at the corner of Fountain and Vine.
Chase Gordon, Davison Young and Gordon California Properties.
Matthew Severson, I'm working for the bid.
Elizabeth McDonald, LA Film School, and the Gordon School Director of Campus Development.
Lauren Lackerton, the Administrative Coordinator here for the bid.
Devin Strecker, Director of Communications and Social Media for the bid.
Arthur Stroman, Kilroy Realty Asset Manager, Hollywood.
Fabio Conti from Fabio Cucina Restaurant and probably the owner of Plants and Vine Bid.
Carol Massey with Thomas.
I'm James Bayou, the Executive Director of CLA, owner operator of the Hollywood Farmers Market.
Kim Sethalter, Urban Legend Theater.
I'm Bronwyn Kiner with Metro.
All right, so Michael, would you like to take over and report from the nominating committee?
Sure. We have two actions to take today. The election of new board members. And these, as you can see on the agenda, they're being elected for three-year terms. And that is David Calabresi, Brian Fulb, Chase Gordon, Fred Rosenthal, and Adam Tarkovsky.
If he can say
from
your
one
name,
ski
you can
to
say
another,
him,
yeah, exactly. I guess I will make a motion to nominate for these five individuals for three-year terms.
Second?
I'll second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions?
I have to abstain since I'm on the slate.
No.
And then the second action is to elect the slate of officers, which again on the agenda you can see is President Fabio has agreed to run. Elizabeth has agreed to stand for vice president, and Arthur and Kitty will remain in the officer positions that they are, or to continue on in their positions. So I'm happy to make a motion to elect this slate of officers.
All right, second. Chase. All those in favor? Against? Abstentions? Thank you. Passed. Well, welcome, everybody, and congratulations to the new slate of officers. And we adjourn the meeting now.
Great, and you will hand over the gavel and to the new president, and we will set Carol tonight at dinner, so just save your roasting comments for
later. So now we're going to adjourn the...
Carol adjourned, you just have to call to meet you after the order.
So I'm going to call to order, and we'll like to start with a public comment.
Bronwyn is here. We have two public comments.
Okay.
So Bronwyn, you can start.
Okay, great. Thank you all for having me. My name is Bronwyn Kiner. I'm a community relations officer with Metro. I want to thank Carrie and Carol for having me here today. A couple weeks ago, Patty Soto, my boss, briefed the Hollywood Property Owners Association, so we wanted to reach out to as well. personally been attending some of those meetings, and we wanted to first thank the Hollywood community for all of your support and patience and understanding during the Metro Red Line construction. That was a positive public-private partnership. And also, today I wanted to provide just a brief overview of our system, some of the projects that we have in the works and existing, as well as an overview of the potential ballot measure. So Metro is unique in that we are a trifecta of transportation, the transit, highways, and the regional planner as well. We're serving a 1,433 square mile service area with 88 cities. From the desert to the beaches, that's 10 million Angelenos. We also provide funding for local streets and city improvements through our partnership with the local cities. So I always like to do a pop quiz. We've come a long way since 1980. We had one freeway and a carpool lane, no rail. When did we reinitiate a rail service with the Metro Blue Line to Long Beach? It was 1990. Metro Blue Line to Long Beach reinitiated rail service in Los Angeles. And we've come a long way. Since then, we now have 88 miles of rail, 2,200 buses providing service on 170 routes. And that's a lot in a short period of time, and we're continuing with more construction. We have a record 5 rail lines under construction, 2 of which will open this year. That's the Gold Line Foothill extension that's opening Saturday, March 5th, and the Exposition Line, which will open soon thereafter. We also have the Crenshaw LAX Transit Corridor, the Regional Connector, and the Purple Line Subway extension. And when you look on your map, so that's a strong foundation to plan for future transportation. We also have several highway improvements. And I think this map is very helpful because it shows you the existing lines, the lines that are under Major R for extension, including the construction lines I just mentioned, as well as the lines that are being planned. And in initial planning, right now we have East San Fernando Valley Transit Corridor, the Airport Metro Connector, South Bay Metro Green Line Extension, the East Side Transit Corridor Phase 2, and Santa Ana Branch and Sepulveda Pass projects. So that was the 12 projects for Major R, as well as the Orange Line, which is already open. But there's still much more to do. So LA County is expected to grow by another 750,000 in the next 10 years. And we're looking at expanding LA County's transportation network. So with more highway and transit alternatives, local improvements and resources to keep the services in good operating condition, it's going to take a combination of local, federal, and private dollars to fund future transportation improvements. So we're looking at an additional local sales tax investment that will allow Metro to deliver more projects sooner rather than later. And the governor recently signed into law SB 767, which authorizes Metro to put a sales tax measure on the future ballot. So Metro's considering pursuing that sales tax election in November for the additional half cent. What does this mean for you? On 5 cents on a $10 purchase. We're looking at that as an estimated $50 a year in easing traffic. So when you compare that with buying a coffee drink once a week, roughly $260 a year, or eating fast food once a week, estimated $420 a year, it's a modest investment that would bring major benefits, including more transportation alternatives, more ways to connect through technology, more community improvements, and more quality time. More time for you. Why now? Well, we spend an average of 70 hours a year stuck in traffic. Time is money. The time it takes to build that transportation improvements, the more expensive it will be. And if we don't plan now for future growth, the gains of recent years will give way to more congestion. Some assumptions for the potential ballot measure include augmenting the current tax and extending the current tax and sunset year. And these assumptions would generate an estimated $120 billion through 2057. So that would be roughly $60 billion for new capital projects and $60 billion for the local investments and operations, et cetera. And that would include, those assumptions would include all the projects that the subregions of Los Angeles County submitted. We had a bottoms-up planning process with the 9 subregions of the county. Submitting projects for evaluation. And that means about half the plan would be dedicated to the capital projects, transit and highway. And then the other half of the plan would cover the local investments, highway improvements, bike and ped projects, connecting through technology, that sort of thing. We are currently evaluating the major transit and highway projects with established performance metrics. And these metrics are based on industry best practices, and they reflect feedback from the board and regional stakeholders. So those performance metrics, themes and weights are, does the project improve mobility? Does it ease congestion, improve travel times and reliability? Increase active transportation at 45%. The second would be, does the project improve accessibility and provide access service to the transit dependent, cyclists, youth, pedestrians, seniors, and people with disabilities? Increase those served by Metro and improve first and last mile connections. That weighs in at 17.5%. And then we're looking at the economy. Does the project grow economic benefits and create jobs, increase goods movement, and invest in disadvantaged communities at 12.5%? Also looking at safety, does the project enhance personal and public safety, reduce incidents, weighing in at 12.5%? Finally, sustainability and quality of life, does the project reduce greenhouse gas emissions, improve air quality, and positively impact health, also at 12.5%. All right, so project evaluation process. The process will be the foundation for developing the expenditure plan, and this plan includes the cost estimates and the schedules for the major construction projects. It's really important to note that would provide an opportunity to potentially accelerate some major R projects that are already in the pipeline while keeping other existing projects on their current schedule. So next steps, we are currently conducting the evaluation, and that evaluation will feed into the expenditure plan, which is going to the board in March. We'll be collecting public comment March through June, and the board will make a decision on the November tax vote in June or July. At the latest. I also wanted to highlight that our website, we have a website, theplan.metro.net, where you can gather more information on the potential ballot measure. Before I leave it at that, I just wanted to highlight the Crenshaw-LAX Northern Extension Feasibility Study. I know this is an issue that's near and dear to your hearts in Hollywood. And just to go over that study, we are looking at extending the Metro Crenshaw-LAX line north via the Purple Line to connect up with Hollywood and Highland, and we're looking at three potential routes, La Brea, Fairfax, and La Cienega, as potential connection points through the Purple Line and subway. We are going to be initiating our conceptual feasibility study in March, and that's just the very beginning, looking at initial ridership estimates and cost estimates that will help us determine whether we should move into a full-blown corridor study for that potential route. Question?
I see the Purple Line stops at La Cienega. I assume you guys are still dealing with Beverly Hills Line.
That's actually moving, but we're in construction on the Purple Line extension.
Okay.
So the first phase, as you said, we're going to La Cienega. That's right. So that'll open hopefully in 2024.
Okay.
And then phase two, we're moving forward. Phase two would go all the way to Century City. And phase three would go all the way to Westwood. But we are in construction on phase one up to that point in La Cienega.
Cool.
So would this additional sales tax accelerate the Purple Line?
Excellent question. Right now, the answer is this study is not currently included in the long-range transportation plan, but the councils of government have submitted this project for inclusion in the LRTP update and on the potential ballot measure. But it's going to be coming out the expenditure plan in March. Currently, no projects have been included in the expenditure plan. So we will all find out very soon. Any other questions?
One more. Did they figure out for the high school if they're going under the field or if they're going under the buildings?
That I don't know, but I can get back to you.
Okay.
Thank you all.
Mm-hmm.
Really appreciate it.
And
now we move on to James and Kim. Tell us more about
We didn't bring a PowerPoint, but handout in front of you. Sorry. I've been involved with the Sunshine Valley bid for a while, but I'll reintroduce myself because there's some new faces here. My name is James Hadu. I'm the executive director of an organization called CLA, Sustainable Economic Enterprises of Los Angeles. And we are the owner-operator of seven certified farmers markets in Los Angeles, Hollywood being the oldest and the largest. And we are about to embark on what we feel is a really important community event for Hollywood, and that is the 25th anniversary of the Hollywood Farmers Market. It was launched on May 1st, 1991. So we have been working with my board of directors, a committee that we formed, an ad hoc committee related to the formation of the event. And I spoke with Devin's committee, the marketing committee, Devin? A few months ago when we were in the planning stages of this, and we had some pretty big visions about a year-long celebration. And as we started to work on our budget, those expectations had to be narrowed a little bit. So what we did was we decided that we would celebrate every Sunday, which is the day that the market operates weekly, during the month of May. We will kick off the event on Sunday, May 1st. That is the day that is closest to the founding day, which is May 5th. But we will run concurrent events through the other four Sundays during the month of May as well. We think that May 1st is probably the biggest, that's the seminal sort of day that we're hoping that we can glean as many partners in Hollywood to participate with us as possible. There will be a main stage that will be programmed with music. A lot of the market buskers or market musicians that you see, we're working. Kim is set off their Urban Legend PR, is our PR and event firm that we're working with, and she's helping us activate that stage. We've invited the mayor to participate, Councilmember O'Farrell from CD13. The interesting part of that is some of our legacy farmers will be joining us. We have about 10 farmers who have been there every Sunday since 1991, and we'll be celebrating them. We are activating a culinary stage for those five Sundays. Our May 1st kickoff chef is Susan Finnegar, and we are outreaching to some fairly well-known cookbook authors and food authorities to give lectures, book signings, and things like that. We are really hoping, and there's a lot of information in this, I'd like you to look at it, and we are trying to round up as many business sponsor partners as we can, but we are willing to work with our shared business community and craft whatever type of package may be suitable for you, and how you would like to reach the 12,000 customers who shop at the Hollywood Farmers Market every Sunday. It's an incredible venue to reach a lot of very diverse shoppers. We see every income, every geographic part of Los Angeles comes from near and far to come to that market. It is notably probably one of the largest farmers markets in the United States, and we feel that we are poised to give it its due in May for 25 years of service to the Hollywood community. So feel free to hang on to these, look through them. Kim and I are starting to do some pretty active rounding up of media partners. Do you want to talk about that a minute?
When we're talking to KCRW about doing our advertising, similar to what you actually did for the Sunset and Vine Festival, and they're wonderful partners to have. We're also talking to Sunset Magazine and LA Magazine, so that's on the sponsorship side. And then we're looking to do a lot of PR through shows like Eye on LA, do a special show devoted to the market and its history, and good food on KCRW and things like that. So we should get a lot of exposure thanks to that.
Our goal, of course, is to make it as Hollywood-centric as possible, engaging as many of our business partners. And as many, especially food-related business partners, restaurants. Again, we have five Sundays to fill the culinary stage with, and we're working very hard on that. And of course, we're encouraging as many of our chef partners as possible to source from the Hollywood Farmers Market. And a lot of them do already, but we feel that tie-in is very, very important.
Doesn't the Top Chef show originate out of the Sunset Media Center? Or the production company?
There's a couple of potential situations we can explore.
Yeah.
Talking to some other production companies in our building to do some food shows.
We've, and Arthur, just so you know, thank you for that. We've begun a preliminary outreach with BuzzFeed. We met with Devin and Jill a couple of weeks ago, Perry, when you were out of town, and that was a very, very productive meeting. So thank you, Devin, for that. But please, any ideas you have that we may not have tapped into yet to help make this as broad as possible? And I mean that sincerely. This is a community celebration. It's, you know, I think of it. Those of you who know me, coming out of our past, we weren't totally community-oriented, and it's changed, and we just feel so good about where we are, and we want to include everybody in the 25-year anniversary. So if you have any questions, let me know. My information is on the back page of that. And more to come. We're launching a 25th anniversary specific website sometime next week, probably.
Mm-hmm. So I'll have printed materials that we can have, providing you got to our members and stuff, or you want to drive most of it electronically?
I would love to drive most of it electronically, but we will have some printed collateral we can use. Absolutely. So anything like that you need?
Those boots you have to buy.
You're
going to rent those boots.
Those
boots.
Well, yeah, we will figure out how to package that for you. We have some, we laid out in the sponsorship deck some of the more defined levels of sponsorship that we're looking for to help cover costs and things like that. But we will work with anybody who has a creative idea about how they want to present that. Without a doubt.
Beautiful.
I'll
wish you all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We need to
have a question for James.
Thank you all.
Really
appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right, so let's move on to the approval of the board minutes. I hope everybody had a chance to take a look at them. Any questions? Any second? Everyone in favor? Anybody against?
I'm abstaining. I wasn't here.
Okay. Beautiful. So, approved. And now we'd like to hear from
on the treasurer's report then, what is included is the first page actually is the 2015, we have not closed that out yet, so this is the same report that was from last month. There isn't anything to approve. We'll have the closeout report next month. Carrie, is there anything you want to add?
Yeah, the only other thing just to let you know is we did get this past week the first installment of about $500,000. Joe knows the exact amount, but he is out sick today. So our first installment has come in for the year, which is good. And then also to let you know, and I talked to Kitty about this today, we're gonna seek a bid from Fabio Bosco, who's an accountant, on doing a financial review for us. In the past, we've had RBZ do that. Just wanna see if there's another option out there and what the cost would be. That's the next step now. When we close out 2015, the city requires us to do a financial review, which is one step short of an audit. So we'll bring back plans for that for the next board meeting as well.
All right, so that's it. Done. Uh-huh. I'll end on to the media and program reports and credit to me. Right?
The meeting is supposed to be tomorrow, but we're deciding about possibly postponing it to March because we have a Finn response for the security committee. But the one thing I will report on is that a few weeks ago, we did have a meeting with a number of property owners on Vine Street. I think this has been a really productive way of handling some of the community problem solving in both bids in the past year. So we brought in folks from the Social Security Administration up to the Goodwill Dollar Store and some of the residents in that neighborhood who have experienced challenges with people who are camping out, you know, in the Goodwill parking lot at night or on the lawn at the Taco Bell, etc. And I think it was pretty productive because everybody did some soul searching on what they could do to make the area safer. The owner of the property where Goodwill and Dollar Store is found out that the gate was actually broken and he agreed to get that fixed. And the owner of the property where the Taco Bell and is that a Pizza Hut also? Is it a combo? Is considering hiring security at night. You know, we explained that sometimes the fast food restaurants can be a magnet for issues, and the bid patrol cannot be the private security for those establishments, and LAPD cannot be there all the time. So I've been gone for 2 weeks. I need to kind of check back and see what they thought about that. So I don't know. Fred was there at the meeting because he's got some affiliation there. What did you think about it?
I thought it was pretty good. I think, again, the issue that we've seen citywide with the increase in homelessness and crime is impacting everybody. And I don't think the tenants necessarily know why, but this is why. So it's going to be, I think, a common issue that's going to be raised.
Right, and you'll recall some of those neighbors came into this meeting, I think on two different occasions, to express their concerns about the fact that they didn't feel safe walking up Vine Street, whereas they did when they had initially moved in. So there has been kind of a shift in kind of the behaviors on the sidewalk. So I think at the end of the discussion, everyone knows each other now. We got everyone's, you know, email and phone number so that they can talk to each other and realize that, you know, LAPD or the bid cannot solve all those problems. They've got to take some action for their own properties as well. So that happened.
But that was not a security.
It would be a good example of us, you know, going off, you know, taking something out of the committee and dealing with it directly.
When was that? January?
It was like the last week in January. Homeless count was Thursday the 28th. I think Brian participated.
Yeah.
Anybody else from this bid? I mean, a lot of you have done it before, so it's, you know. Brian, how was it and where did you go?
Okay, you know, we all had designated areas that we were assigned. It's pretty well planned out operation. It's difficult to assess specifically because you see a lot of people standing on the street and they give us a very specific program on how we do the count. Obviously, if there's somebody sleeping in a sleeping bag on the street, we're going to count that as one. But, you know, sometimes you see young people that are hanging out playing music or whatever. You don't necessarily know whether they're homeless or not. We ran into that. So, and then you've got drug addiction issues and things like that. You don't necessarily know whether they're homeless either. So, sorry for not looking this way as well.
I'm sorry,
you guys. I should stand up, but it was, it's an important experience to go out. I'm actually going, I think, on the 12th to do the assessment where we actually go out and meet people and talk to people, and we're going to do an assessment survey on what's really going on with a lot of the folks out on the street. And there's a lot of folks from the business community, you know, Carrie, you kind of head up that group, that are really concerned about this and want to really know what's going on with a lot of these different issues with respect to the broad term of homelessness. So I actually was up in the residential area north of Hollywood Boulevard, basically between Wilcox and Highland, all the way up to Yucca. And we covered all of those blocks up there and really didn't see very much. I mean, I think we had to go along the boulevard, so we saw some things along the boulevard that we entered in, but didn't see very much homeless activity or people sleeping in vehicles or anything like that. There are different categories, like a so-called encampment, where you have a group of people that are apparently camping out on the street, for lack of a better description, and then, or individuals, people living in a vehicle, if you see that that's an obvious situation. We didn't see really any of that, just some individuals sleeping. And the residential area up where we were was actually very clean, very well maintained. You know, in the 40 years that I've been involved in Hollywood, I haven't seen that, a whole big swath area like that that looked really good. And you know, I have to think that the bids had something to do with that. Just, you know, all of the work that we've done to clean and provide more security and so forth, I think it's really made a difference in the people that want to live and work in this neighborhood here. I was very, very impressed with what I saw. Just, you know, a neighborhood where a lot of people were out walking, couples, a lot of young people, not like I've seen in the past in Hollywood. So that part of it was good. And I think in the 3 hours that we were out there, we had a total count. This is a, you know, about a 5 mile walk. We counted eight homeless. That was it.
So the results won't be known until May for the, now it's an annual count. I was down in like mid city at a Kaiser hospital off of Interstate 10 helping that group down there. So it's too soon to tell what the numbers are going to look like. If I were to guess, I would say that the unsheltered count will remain roughly the same or maybe a little bit less. I think where we're going to see an uptick is in encampments, vehicles, RVs, etc. I also am predicting that we are going to see an increase within the city limits of Los Angeles of those types of encampments because of the ACLU lawsuit. Because, you know, you can pitch a tent in LA from 9 to 6, you cannot pitch a tent in another city. So it'll be interesting to see if there has actually been a migration of that activity into the city of Los Angeles.
Another interesting statistic on our report was that the homeless that we did see were all male, between like 20 and 30, probably, young males in their 20s.
The last item is that we had a conversation at the security committee meeting last month, and it's going to be discussed again at the Hollywood board meeting next week. LAPD has asked us to consider rearranging our patrol and resources to put more attention to nighttime security up to from like 8 to 4 in the morning. One of the problems that we face is that we have a finite budget, and if we were to shift any resources to those hours, we would have to eliminate, for example, the 6 a.m. patrol or maybe patrol during the middle of the day. And that patrol is very busy and is very important to the stakeholders in Hollywood.
Is there pricing differential, hours and
days? No pricing differential, no. So I've been gone for 2 weeks. I know there's been a few meetings to prepare different plans for that. And like I said, I think we're gonna cancel tomorrow's security meetings. We didn't have enough people really showing up for that, where we would have probably had a discussion, but it'll be, it's not gonna impact Sunset. It would only impact the Hollywood bid patrol. All right, so that's it for the security.
Nobody from vendors here. Let's move on to Devin, marketing, communication, Sunset and Dine.
Sure. We had a meeting last week of the Sunset Dine Planning Committee. So we discussed a few different things, actually a lot of different things, because this is the 5th annual event this year. The first and foremost is we are considering moving the event back to early summertime, like it was the first 2 years, so possibly sometime in June, maybe. I also had a meeting with one of the people who's in charge of planning the Abbott Kinney Festival, the Off Sunset Festival, the Rendezvous Market in Santa Monica, and the Main Street Festival in Pioneertown. So we got a lot of ideas of how we can expand the event with possibly adding a vendor fair or some sort of carnival ride or rides, games, more entertainment, and then separating out the beer garden. Before, the alcohol was for anybody at the whole event. If we section that off, it'll make things a lot easier and could increase the revenue for the event. We were looking at a few different locations, and some of you will be hearing this for the first time because I have been calling people since the last meeting. So we were talking about Blessed Sacrament parking lot. Unfortunately, they're very concerned about the construction that's going on with the center, and they just don't think it would work out this year. So maybe next year we can move it there. So some of the other locations that we've been looking into was Hollywood Athletic Club. I called and got some pricing for that. Also the Palladium, which we've been talking to them about that. And then most promising, the LA Film School, which we had looked at and identified as a location previously, but it didn't work out before because of the issue with the alcohol. So if we do separate the alcohol into the beer garden, that would make it easier to open it up to Los Angeles Film School. So I did get some pricing and information from Elizabeth today, and I'll schedule a meeting with the committee probably next week so that we could move forward with that. But we would ask the board to allocate the regular $5,000 from the budget for the event, just so that we can start planning that if we need to put down any deposits on anything or if we need to secure anything before next month's board meeting. I will get the proposals for anything to bring to the board for next month, including the PR, if we decide to hire a PR company for this again.
So we need somebody to move the expenditure of $5,000 for planning, communication, media relation for Sunset and Dine.
So moved.
Anybody want to second these? Second? Yeah. So we're all in favor. Right. Anybody against this? Anybody abstained? Okay. Passed it.
Thank you. And then we have mentioned before that as you see in our storefront windows are a great prime real estate for us to kind of promote different things going on here in Hollywood, tell the story of Hollywood. And so we'd like to ask for anyone's help who's interested in helping us figure out how to program those windows on a changing basis, whether it's monthly or quarterly. So we have scheduled a meeting for this Thursday, the 11th at 2 p.m. here in the office. I've sent out an email to all of you, but I'll send out a reminder in case any of you want to attend that.
And that meeting is for?
That's for the, it's kind of a marketing brainstorm.
No,
for the,
what time?
It's 2 o'clock.
Oh, you changed it.
We changed it, yes.
Thank you. Okay.
Thank you.
Sadia, can I make one more?
Please.
For those of you that are new, with respect to Sunset and Dine, all of our profits go to one of our local charities. In the last couple of years, they've gone to the Center at Blessed Sacrament, which focuses primarily on the homeless issues in our community here. And we're very proud of that. I think this last year we issued a check for $6,000, and I think that's a really nice thing that we do with that event.
Okay, do we get some money from the city about the center?
The center got its first
installment check.
$260,000.
So most likely that is not going to stop.
Right.
So construction going to keep going on because. Yeah. You know, we had a meeting last week. I'm like, I don't know if that's going to happen. But now we got.
Yeah, the center started its construction, its renovation back in July. It's a $2 million renovation of that old convent on the campus at Blessed Sacrament. And the city still had not issued the money as of like last week from these federal funds that have been sitting there for years. So the first check finally.
Is the check being collected?
It was collected. Okay. Yeah.
So.
Which is good, because construction folks have not been paid for like 7 months.
Yeah. So that's a good news.
Very good.
So it could happen that we're gonna have it at the Blessed Sacrament, Sunset and Dine.
Okay.
Oh, well, if it's done in time, I mean.
If it's done in time.
Yeah.
So let's not just scratch that off.
Yeah.
For this. Beautiful. And now we got Chase.
Yes. Okay, starting with the utility boxes. If you'll remember at our January 12th meeting, we had received approval on our revised artwork for the utility box program. The ball has been with Mitch's office since. We're waiting for them to submit to DOT. Once they do so, it should take 1 to 3 days and we'll be ready to rock and roll. We are hoping, Matthew's been talking to them, to have a response by the end of the week. So that's a good progress there. And then we also have the website that will be linked to via the QR codes on the boxes themselves.
So this is kind of a draft template, and thanks Devin for helping put this together. This is what we're anticipating will link to the QR stickers that we print out on each of the boxes. So when you scan the code, it'll take you to this page. We envision having a standalone tab right here that says public art, and eventually we'll link to other public art projects in the district. But for now, this is what we have for the utility boxes. It's includes an overview of kind of the artist concept and direction, a little bit about the artist, her statements. And then we just jump into each of the artworks, and there's a description of each of the bands that that she painted. And it's also kind of cool because we've included this dynamic feature. It's a link to each of the band's SoundCloud pages, so you can kind of listen to the music. And the artist listened to this music as she was painting the artwork. So we have 10 pieces and 10 bios.
That is super cool.
That is really cool.
Yeah.
Kudos to Devin.
Yeah. Nice job, guys.
Well done. Next, the LA Moss installation at the southwest corner of Selma and Ivar. We were delayed on that, but now we're tracking for mid-April, and this is due to one El Nino coming. We think it'll last a little better if we push it back a little bit. And secondly, and probably more importantly, LA Moss's schedule. So we're tracking for a mid-April installation, and they're going to collect community feedback during the Hollywood Farmers Market and help that to inform projects moving forward, which should help us get grants as well. The community engagement, that's been kind of a key part of this entire project, is it'll help us meet some of the requirements for public art grants.
Members, they probably don't know what the LA Moss project is, so maybe enlighten them.
Yeah, so we're creating a pocket park on the southwest corner of Ivar and Selma. It's the parking lot behind Space 1520 and Big Wang's. There is a dirt plot, you can't even call it a yard, with a small billboard on it. And we've worked with the ownership and his attorney, as well as Urban Outfitters, who has a master lease on the property, for approvals, and we're going to construct at our own cost and our own maintenance with LA Moss, who is a nonprofit art group working in Los Angeles, to install a pocket park. So we're gonna have some benches, some shade, right? And shade as well. And it's very cool.
Just moving.
I'll be sending the package. Yeah, it's making progress.
Beautiful.
So.
I wanna see it happen.
And then
you have the Sunset Boulevard landscaping.
Yeah, you brought this up earlier. It's the pilot program that we were running for the planters at the corner, four corners of Sunset and Vine. They were installed January 28th, so it's been just about 2 weeks almost. And to date, we've had no problems, no vandalism.
They look very nice.
Mm-hmm. No issues at all.
Some photos.
Yeah, so if you haven't seen them, I'd encourage you to drive by as well, because it looks great.
And there's more planned to be installed, or just
yes.
just
We'll address that a little bit later. Okay. And then also we approved funds to landscape the tree wells along Sunset between El Centro and Cahuenga. We haven't started yet just because we're working with the contractor to find a time that's amenable to him. And we're going to be testing a few different plant options for the future in the next couple of weeks before we really firm up what we're going to.
This looks like the drought resistant and low maintenance.
Yep.
Do you have to water them like once a month or something? Or?
We're watering them once a week right now.
Wow.
Just to get them established.
Okay.
But after that, we'll be able to let up. But we have a Moraya, asparagus fern, and succulents in the planters right now. And we're kind of a little out of order. We're going to jump into an action item in a few. But so this is the current location. Actually, we can skip around. So we'll just jump into it. So we have four right now at the intersection of Sunset and Vine, and we got a call from the vendor we purchased the trash cans from, the planters from, and they're offering a free freight special for February. So we did make this initial purchase as kind of a pilot, hoping that we would be able to purchase more and place them throughout the district. So right now would be a good time to make that investment in some additional planters. They have only been out there for 2 weeks, but as Chase mentioned, we haven't had any issues so far. There's a handout in your packet. It's the estimate from the vendor. We got a quote for 16 additional planters. So you'll see the cost there. We are anticipating savings of about, I believe it was $2,300 in freight.
$2,267.
There you go. In freight. So if we made this purchase, we would basically be taking those savings and using it to purchase the plant materials and have them installed. So we are looking for approval of a $13,200 amount. 16 planters, so you can see these are the locations that we are considering. We haven't had a streetscape committee meeting this year yet, so these are just kind of tentative locations. So if we receive approval to make this purchase, we'll be confirming with the committee that these are in fact the best locations for the planters. We just kind of picked areas that had a lot of pedestrian foot traffic and would have the most visual impact in the neighborhood.
Has the vendor indicated how long the installation will take?
The production to actually have them delivered is about 10 weeks. So,
and then how long to put them out on the street?
I think we did this in 2 hours in the morning.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Are they bolted?
They are not bolted. They are not there. They are very heavy. We filled them with 2 feet of rocks. So
we hope to have two on Sunset and Gower too. Is that Gower?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. So it's
that was Ronson. Yeah,
it's Gower, Ivar, and Cahuenga along Sunset.
Okay, Matthew, I'm just trying to understand the math here.
Sure.
So you're asking for 13.2.
Uh-huh.
It's 10,708 without the freight and packing. So what's the difference?
So,
the materials to the plants and the rocks.
Oh, this is just, okay.
This is just for the...
The difference of the materials,
yeah,
and those so, from another vendor.
And so the freight and packing doesn't quite make up for the additional, but it's awfully close.
Okay, got it.
So
we should approve it this meeting. Next month is not going to, the savings is not going
to
be around.
Exactly, we have to move quickly on this to take advantage of this.
I'll make the motion to.
All right, beautiful. We have a mover. A mover.
And I will say, we were thinking of pulling $10,000 out of the old bid account. We have about $48,000 available there, and then the balance we would take from the beautification budget.
That's a good idea. You want to put that in the motion?
Yeah, so 10 grand from, with a motion to pull 10,000 from the old bid revenue and the balance from the current beautification budget.
I'll second that.
Beautiful. Go ahead in favor.
Bye.
Next.
pictures are coming.
Thank you.
Well done.
Thank you.
Good job, guys.
I see your Green Street contract update.
Yeah, so this is just a brief note. We've been noticing a couple of inconsistencies in our maintenance vendor in terms of how they provide data and reports to us. So Joe and I will be working this month to come up with a system in which we can audit their contract and make sure they are fully complying to our agreement with them. So that's just something that we feel is necessary so we can make sure they are doing what they're supposed to be doing out there, and coming up with some new systems so that we can make sure that we're tracking that information correctly. Right now we have a lot of qualitative information on the work that's being done, but we don't have a lot of hard data right now, which we feel we will need for the bid renewal, which is coming up. So, you know, Kara, if you want to expand on that at all.
Just that when we were at the IBA conference in San Francisco, we were pretty impressed with the technologies that exist now to really track what bids are doing, security, maintenance, you know, just with iPhones and GPS, there's just such a robust way to really, you know, document your activities. And we realized that we're a little bit behind the eight ball on that, and our vendor hasn't really been maybe part of that technology wave. So yeah, we all came back, and I think we shared that with you when we did our 10 things we learned at IBA, that we're not keeping up with technology. So not sure where this will lead, you know, not sure if this vendor is capable of absorbing that kind of activity, but it's definitely where the industry is going.
Yeah, so we'll be looking at some software options, some operations management software, and we will be going through that process with the Streetscape and Planning Committee, so you know, we'll at least consider and see what our options are.
Is this for Clean Street?
For Clean Street.
Andrews?
Yeah, and maybe Andrews. Andrews, you know, maybe does already have some good kind of tracking of their activity, but definitely Clean Street. Everything they do is manual. So we're talking about writing things on paper, using a highlighter, X's, things like that.
The last security meeting, two things that struck me, it was like there's a very simple item we didn't take care of. Like, one is signage. Mm-hmm. We're talking about certain things, you know, the because the police is going to do because there's not a lot of
signage, right.
And they cannot take pictures with their own phones. And how can you have security cars out there not be able to, you know, collect
data
and stuff like that? So probably something we need to work on that side.
Definitely, I mean, with the, especially on the maintenance side, just to be able to capture photos of tree conditions and sidewalk conditions and this and that would be super useful and have them transmitted into the office. And as we move into bid renewal, we want to be able to let property owners know what have you done for me around my property lately. Will we be able to show them this is what we do, this is when we wash your sidewalk, this is how many times we pick up your trash, and it's kind of hard to document that right now.
Like, Andrew's doing a pretty good job with their reports. I don't think Clean Street is doing any report.
Right. And you got guys out there sweeping. I mean, how they can't, like, write everything they're doing. But if they had a smartphone, maybe they could track it better.
Okay, so we have the, what's going on here?
Change
you
order?
Change
order.
Are
we
doing
the
change order now?
This is a different item.
Separate.
Yeah.
Yeah, so this, you also have a handout. This is a change order to our existing contract. We're updating the contract to reflect what we're doing right now in terms of landscaping. So this is just showing the landscaper, their duties, how often they're working, and their watering schedule. So we have that red line showing the proposed changes to the agreement.
And that's something we need to act on now?
Yes.
And they're able to do that within their existing contracts?
Yes.
Because they've already got people out doing that.
Yeah, I mean,
similar
they're pretty accommodating, you know, they're not going to nickel and dime us.
Yeah, this does not change our costs or anything.
sure you went through this, you think it's safe.
Yep. Just need your approval to send it to the bank.
Anybody wants to move?
I'll move.
Mover, second?
I just had a couple of questions.
Please, let's talk about it.
So, yeah, just very quickly. So the press rip kit thing, taking that out?
Well, we're not on that one yet.
Oh, I'm wrong.
This one?
No. I thought it was the change order for the...
The change order for the landfill.
Oh, okay.
Does landscape planners on Sunset Boulevard, will that include everything that we're discussing about the...
Yep, that's why we left it. We didn't allocate a number for a quantity of planters, since that's going to be changing. We don't have to keep amending the contract each time.
Thank you. Any other questions? All in favor with this?
Did you get a second?
Yes.
I don't think it's...
Oh, okay, sorry.
Okay, I saw this before.
Okay.
So anybody against this or abstained? Okay. All right, so passed.
Thank you. And just a